Hey viewers, this is Geek Gardener and welcome to part 2 of our guide to understanding pH in hydroponics. In the last video, we talked about what is pH, what should be the ideal range of pH for growing plants, and what happens when the pH goes up and when the pH goes down, and how to adjust pH in your reservoir, theoretically. In this video, I'm going to touch upon some more advanced topics such as calibration and different ways of measuring pH. And then in the end, I'm also going to practically demonstrate how to adjust pH for a smaller hydroponic reservoir and also strategies on adjusting for a larger farm as well. So we'll try to see how to squeeze all these things into a not too long video. Hang in there, it's going to be fun. So let's dive right in. Today, I'm going to show you about few methods of measuring pH. First, I have the pH strips. So this is pH strip. Okay, so I hope you can see. So you can measure up to 1 to 14 in this. So basically, it is just a small booklet and all my yellow colored leaves, pages, and you need to dip these pages in the solution that you want to measure pH of. And based on the color change, you will come to know what is the range of pH the solution is having. The best part about this is super cheap. But the disadvantage with this method is that you will only know an approximate range and not an accurate number. You will know probably your water is over 7-8 or it's below 7. That's a good idea you will get about your water based on this strip. But if you want to know is it 6.3 or 6.4, this is not going to help you there. So it is good for a beginner to check the water quality, but if you are a practitioner of hydroponics, I would suggest you should buy a handheld meter. Now, to demonstrate various pH values and ratios, I have with me three standard solutions whose pH is already determined. Okay, and these are called buffer solutions in the chemical world. And these buffer solutions are also going to be very, very useful in your hydroponic journey. I have with me three buffer solutions. 4, 7, and 10. Okay. I'm also going to tell you why you need three of them, or at least two of them, to have an accurate pH measurement with your pH meter. Now, let's do a small demonstration with the pH strip. Okay, so now we are going to measure or test these pH strips using our standard solutions, which is called a buffer solution, like I said. I have 4, 7, and 10. So let's see how these strips perform with all these things and how easy or difficult it is to use strips to identify what pH and what range we're looking at. Okay, just follow me. So I hope you can see this clearly. This is a strip and these are color codes. 1 to 7, you flip it over, 8 to 14. This is the shades of green to light and darkest green, and this is shades of pink to orange, and then you have a whole lot of small booklet, if you will. So these are strips that we take individually to dip it in each of these things and we are going to find out this pH. And this is the dabba I got. There's a whole lot of books, don't have to worry. So the brand of pH paper I'm using is from Toma End Papers. Range is 1 to 14, 10 books and 200 strips. I think the price is roughly 300 odd. So if you would like, I'll put a link for these. It comes with a nice lid and you can just remove this. Put the paper here. Close it. Close it. There you go. Okay, so I'm gonna fill up each one of this. Just take a little bit. Number four. Keep it right in front, let's not do. Ideally, if you want, you can split it and put it. I'm not going to do that. Put another one here. Another one into this. Oops. Wow. Okay. So now, time for some color reading. Okay. This is pH 4. So this perception of color over a camera may be a little difficult for you, but just try to follow along. You see this. I have taken 4, and this is somewhere between 3 and 5. I'm guessing. Yeah, it's 3 and 5. This is the color. So I'm going to leave it like this, if you can. It's between these two, 3 and 5. We don't know exactly where it is, but it's 3 and 5. Now I'm going to do 7. This is the lightest of all. This is 7. Oops. And green here. This is definitely not 1 to 7. So that's a good indication that the strip says it's something else. So I'll leave it to you. Where would you fit this in? The pH is 10. So it looks like it's around 10 or 11. So you get the idea. You know in which range the pH is, but you cannot really pinpoint what is a pH. So that's the difference. That's how the pH strips work. You get an idea, but you only get an idea, not an accurate number. Okay, so now we are going to do with pH meter. Okay, so hang on, let me clear this up and I'll get the pH meter in. So now I'm going to show you how to measure pH with a handheld pH meter. So this is a pH meter, which is from this company called HM Digital. There are multiple brands. You can choose whichever one you like. I've been using this, so I thought I'll demonstrate with this. So there are multiple buttons: power on, enter, temperature, calibration, and hold button. So whenever we get to these features, I'll tell you how to use them. Okay. And here are the electrodes. This is a glass bulb. It's also called a glass electrode. So you need to ensure that you should not store the pH meter dry. Okay. Right now we'll go about how to measure it. Okay. How to measure pH using this. Now I switched it on. This is a sample water I have. So I'm gonna keep it here to measure what is the. So the water reads about 7.7 pH. Another thing we need to note or remember whenever you measure pH is don't take instantaneous readings. Put the meter in the solution, wait for about 30 seconds to 45 seconds for it to stabilize. Sometimes what happens is there'll be remnants from the previous reading stuck on the glass electrode. So for it to really mix, you can give it a mild shake and wait for it to stabilize. When it stabilizes for more than 30 seconds, then you know you have the right reading. With us, I think the number shows here it's 7.6. So we can go with 7.6 as a number here. When you generally take the meter up, the readings change. So that's why the hold button is given. So you can say press hold and it will start. It will not make the number disappear. It will just hold on to that number, even if the liquid is not in contact. So this feature is very useful when you are putting the meter into the solution where you cannot see the meter, but you can just press hold and take it out and see. This is a convenient feature, but yeah, some meters have and some meters don't. If you press hold again, that vanishes. So then it shows some number. Now, it's good. We measured 7.6, but how do we ensure the data is correct? We just took some liquid and measured it. The liquid could be 7.6, maybe not. So the best way to verify that is to make sure the pH meter is reading the correct values for a standard solution that we call a buffer solution. To help you understand calibration, I want to give some examples which everyone can relate to in their life. We all have had eye tests, so it is very similar to a vision test. We go to an optician, get our eyes checked, they give you a chart for you to read from a distance, and then you realize at some point A looks like R, R looks like A. You know, you've all been there. So the A or R didn't change at all. They are always standard. What changed is our ability to perceive those characters in through our lens. And what the optician does is to correct the lens by adding various lenses with different powers. So this correction is called as calibration. During calibration, they have a fixed standard test. With that, we measure our eyes. Similarly, when we're using a pH instrument, or any instrument for that matter, over a long period of time, these instruments, based on how their makeup is, they lose their accuracy. To be specific, I'll give you an example of a pH meter. pH meters are electronic devices. They determine the potential difference or the voltage coming from the solution through the electrodes. These electrodes emit about 59.16 millivolts per unit of pH change. For example, if it gives you 59.16 millivolt, it is pH 1. If it is twice as that, pH 2. If it's negative of that, so if you keep 7 as a reference, one more additional 59.16 millivolt will be 8, one lesser would be 6. But this 59.16 millivolt per unit of pH change is for a good, just out of the factory device. But as the device ages and the maintenance of that, the accuracy slowly goes down. It may not give you the same voltage per unit change. It may give a little lesser. So how do we know how much lesser it is? So for example, after say 1 month or 2 months of usage, it is only giving say 59.1 millivolts. So we need to find the error and make some corrections. Fortunately, we don't have to do all that. There are software or code written in the pH meter can do that. So this calibration is a process where you tell the pH meter, hey, this is 4. Whatever your reading is, assume that, for example, if it is 59.1 instead of 59.16, make corrections so that you don't display the error, but you calculate it accordingly. So this calibration process is like adding another lens to the pH meter, saying you're aged, but you know, we'll help you understand what it is. So I think I have attempted to describe calibration probably. If you have a better example, put it in the comments, but I hope you understand the reason why we calibrate. Say, what happens if we don't calibrate? Over time, the error may get larger, and actually the solution may be 4, it will show you 3 or even 5. Minor errors are forgiven by the crop, but larger errors, say for example, if it is 2 points away, you must be thinking you're adjusting it at 5.5, it could be 3.5. In that case, the crop is going to be taking a lot of hit. You'll see a lot of deficiencies. That could be precipitation in the solution. So it's good to keep your pH meter maintained well and also calibrated frequently to avoid these errors getting accumulated. When I say frequent, not every day, but once in a week or once in 2 weeks also is good. Like I showed in this video, there are a lot of calibration solutions available. The standard ones are 4, 7 and 10. So I hope you understood the calibration process, and if there is any questions that you want me to answer, please put it in the comments and I'll be happy to take care of it for you. Now I'm going to dip it in buffer solution 4 and see if the pH meter comes up with the reading of 4. Like I said, allow it to stabilize. These buffer solutions are not only used to verify the pH meter, but also to make sure the meters can be calibrated to measure the exact value. So when we know the pH meter is reading 4.2, but the solution is actually 4, so it means there is a small error. So then it is important that we calibrate this meter. So for that, now what we are going to do is, there is a cal button. Just keep pressing it for like 10 seconds or so. We are telling this pH meter, this is not 4.2, but this is actually 4. So remember, this solution is 4. And then we press enter. It automatically suggested it is a 4 solution. So I am going to press enter. Now it's stabilizing at 4. So the solution is 4 and the meter also reading is 4. Now this is good, but sometimes it is not enough if you just do for one number. You need to do for two numbers. So I have pH 7 solution with me. Another important thing to note is between calibration with multiple different buffer solutions, it is good to rinse your pH instrument or pH electrode in a deionized water. It is important that the water be deionized or distilled water, because sometimes even RO water has some additional minerals added to it. If you ensure that it is washed between two calibrations, the previous buffer solution does not stick on the bulb and cause an error in the next measurement.
I'm gonna see first if it measures 7 or not. So the solution is 7.0, the reading is about 7.1. We can wait for it to stabilize. If it does not stabilize, we'll calibrate it to pH 7. So just as I said, you may want to add a little more solution just so that well submerged. Now as you can see, still 7.1. So I'm going to press the cal button. It identified it as 7, so I'm going to say press enter. It's going to calibrate it. It's a calibration's over. So this means this solution is a standard 7 solution and we have calibrated the pH meter for solution 7. Now I lift it up, it just went to another number. So if I dip it back, it should go back to 7, which it did. So we have successfully calibrated to 7. In the previous shot, we calibrated it for solution 4. Okay, solution 4. Now we will do it for, we did it for 7. Next I'm going to do it for 10. So stay tuned. So I have taken the solution pH buffer 10 in this lid of it, and I'm gonna see what it's going to measure for pH 10. This particular instrument I'm using, which is pH 80 from HM Digital, is a single point calibration instrument. That means you need only one buffer solution to calibrate it, and it is ideal to choose the one that is closer to the range of values that you will use. For example, 5.5 to 6.5 is closer to 7, so you can use a pH buffer of 7 in this case.
You can give it a stir if you want to, but yeah, it will take some time.
Okay, so we waited for about 30 to 45 seconds. Still it's showing 9.8, so it means it's time to calibrate. So again, I'm pressing the cal button. You will see it blinking. I'm going to press enter. It said calibration is over. So now my calibration is over. Because I lifted off the solution, it's gonna read some stray values. Let's see if I'm putting it back. What is it? It goes back to 10. I took it off the solution. 9.8, back into the solution, 10. So this is a good exercise to do for calibration. If I suggest we do this every 15 days so that your pH meter remains accurate. So now we have done 4, 7 and 10. So starting from this range all the way up to 10, you can use this pH meter for. It will remain accurate in this range. If you don't have 3, you can also use 4 and 7. So between this 4 and 7, pH measurements will be accurate. That's the idea of calibration. So I hope you guys enjoyed the pH and learned a thing or two about this. Give me your feedback in the comments. Whatever suggestions, criticism, please put it in the comments. I'll try my best to address those. And I tried my best to kind of cut this video into a short 5-minute format, but this isn't a 5-minute craft video, so I have to do justice to it. So I have another part coming where I will be going to a farm. I'll take a sample right there from the reservoir. We will measure the pH, adjust the pH, and also show you how to adjust pH for a larger volumes of reservoir. Till then, stay safe and thanks for watching. If you like this video, please do share with your fellow growers and give me your feedback. Thank you. Bye-bye.